Hello everyone, welcome to homeschool. We are with one more session on periodic classification of elements. In the last video we discussed about the Dobrynoff's law of triads, and then we went for Newland's law of octaves, and in this video we will discuss about Mendeleev's periodic table. And you know, Mendeleev's periodic table is a just prior periodic table to our existing modern one. I already said, like, ours is a 46th periodic table, right? So the 45th periodic table was this Mendeleev's periodic table. So most of the concepts, most of the things we have taken from this particular periodic table. Whatever good was there in this periodic table, all the good we took it. The bad things, like whatever the deviations were there, we modified it, and then we have the scientists have put forth our modern periodic table, okay, which we are using. Fine. And let us discuss about the Mendeleev's periodic table now. And it was a table which was introduced in the year 1869. Okay. And during Mendeleev's time, there were 63 elements discovered. 63 elements discovered in total. Fine. And this Mendeleev's periodic table includes the arrangement of elements in the increasing order of their atomic masses. Okay, this is a very important word that you have to remember. Even this guy, like Newland and Dobrynoff, okay, even this guy also arranged the elements in the increasing order of their atomic masses. Of their atomic masses. Remember guys, all the scientists till 45 periodic table, that means all the 45 scientists before ours have been arranged the elements according to the increasing order of their atomic masses only. So Mendeleev is the first person to introduce two important words in his periodic table, that is group and periods. Okay, group and periods. These were the two new words he told about Mendeleev. And what do you mean by a group? Group in the sense vertical column. What is a group here? Vertical column. Okay. And period is horizontal row. Horizontal row. Okay. This is what we call vertical group. Okay, vertical column, which we call it as group, and horizontal rows in the sense these guys. Okay, when you arrange it like this, horizontal rows, in other words, we call periods. And Mendeleev has arranged all the elements in 8 groups and 6 periods. Okay, so let us draw a Mendeleev's periodic table roughly. Imagine this is our group number 1. Group number 1, and this is group number 2, group number 3, group number 4, group number 5, group number 6, okay, group number 7, and group number 8, okay, like this. You know, how many are there? How many vertical columns are there? 8, isn't it? 1, 2, till 8. Okay. So this is our groups. Fine. And how many periods he has arranged? 6. That means this is first period. Okay. First period. And this is our second period. Third period. Fourth period. Fifth period. And sixth period, like this. Okay, so how many groups? 8 vertical columns, that is 8 groups. Okay, and 6 periods. So in this, he has arranged his elements. And remember, each and every group is again subdivided into A and B. Each and every group is again split into A and B. Okay, second group also split into A and B. This is first A, first B, second A, second B. Okay, and third one also split into A and B. fourth is also split into A and B. Okay, like that, you know, every group till 7 has been split into A and B. Okay, but 8th one he did not give such splits. 8th one as a whole is one particular group. Okay, and now what this guy has studied is, he studied each and every chemical and physical properties of 63 elements. Okay, and about them he has listed in a card. He took 63 cards. He actually took 63 cards, plain cards he took. So imagine this is element number 1, first card, element number 2 card, element number 3rd card, element number 4th cards. Okay, this is a card of first element, card of second element, card of third element, like that. 63 cards he made ready, plain cards. And whatever chemical and physical properties he has studied, he listed in the card. He has written in the card, 63 plain cards. Okay, so element number 1 about its chemical and physical properties he studied and he listed in the card. Okay, and the same way the next element's properties he listed in the card. Okay, and what he mainly studied was the reaction of element with oxygen and hydrogen. Okay, so this person studied the reactions of every element with hydrogen and oxygen. So how did the first element reacts with hydrogen and oxygen? That one he has written in this card. And how did the next element reacted with hydrogen and oxygen? He has listed in the another card. Like that, 63 cards with 63 different informations, he made it ready. Okay. And what he could observe is, 3 to 4 elements were having same properties. He could observe the elements were not having different properties. You know, at least 3 to 4 elements reacted in a similar way with hydrogen and oxygen. Okay. So those elements he placed it in one particular group. Okay. Say for example, hydrogen. Okay, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, you know, all these elements will come in a same group. All these elements will come in a same group. He has arranged in a group number 1A. Okay, in 1A group, he has arranged lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium. Why? Because all these elements' properties, when he saw the 63 cards separately, you know, few cards which are similar in the information, no, that one he separated. Like that, whichever elements were having similar information, similar reactions, he separated it. Okay, so what he arranged is lithium, sodium, potassium, they were showing the similar chemical and physical properties. So all these elements he has put it in this particular group. Okay, and after that, you know, copper, silver, gold, platinum, all these elements were showing the same properties, and these elements he has put it in one group. Okay, he has put these elements in 1B group. Okay, after that, in the second group, what he has put is, he has put beryllium, magnesium, okay, calcium, strontium and barium. Okay, all these elements were showing same properties maybe, so he has put them in same group. Okay, like that, you know, he has arranged whichever elements were having common properties, those elements he has put it in one particular group. Like that, he filled his entire groups and periods. Okay, and here I already told you, this guy has mainly studied the elements' reaction with oxygen and hydrogen. Okay, so when these guys, when the elements present in group number 1, okay, when these guys reacts with oxygen, they gave a compounds like, you know, R2O type of oxides. I already told you, whenever some elements react with oxygen, you will get oxide. Okay, so what was the formula of oxide these elements gave? This was the formula. If R is any element present in this first group, if these elements, I am not taking the individual element, I am considering generally the element as R, Okay, so when R, which is belonging to group 1, reacts with oxygen, it gave what type of oxides? R2O type of oxides it gave. Okay, similarly, when these guys reacted with hydrogen, they gave RH type of hydrides. Okay, R is any element which is there in this particular group. Okay, so when that element combined with hydrogen, you get hydride. What was the formula you had? RH. What was the formula? All of them gave R2O type of oxide. See, when lithium combined with oxygen, you got, Li2O. When sodium combined with oxygen, you had got Na2O. When potassium combined with oxygen, you had got K2O. When rubidium combined with oxygen, you had got Rb2O. Okay, like that, all these elements which are there in group 1 reacted in a similar way with oxygen. So instead of writing, like mentioning all, like I took R as one particular element which belongs here, so it gave a formula R2O type. Okay, similarly, when they reacted with hydrogen, these elements gave a hydride of the type RH. Okay, that means when lithium combined with hydrogen, you had got LiH. When sodium combined with hydrogen, you had got NaH, like that. Okay, so similarly, when group 2 elements, when he combined with oxygen, he had got an oxide of the formula RO type. Okay, RO type. And he had got the hydride of the formula RH2 type. Okay, so all these things I will clearly explain with the help of the original Mendeleev's periodic table in the next few minutes. Okay, so this is how he has arranged the elements. Clear, everybody? So he studied the chemical and physical properties of every element. He noted the properties. Whichever elements are showing similar chemical and physical properties, he kept it in one particular group. Okay, and you know, you can observe this, each and every group is divided into A and B. Okay, and if you can observe, you know, group A, the elements which are there in group A are nothing but the S block elements. Actually, when you study the modern periodic table, I'm going to explain what do you mean by S block, P block, D block and all. Okay, so anyway, just try to remember this. 8 groups, okay, and 6 periods, 8 groups, and group number 1 to group number 7, every group is divided into A and B. Group number 8 has not been divided, okay, and he has arranged 3 elements here. Each box had 3 elements, set of 3 elements. Okay, so this is how he gave his periodic table. Okay, so, and the main important interesting point about Mendeleev's periodic table is, you know, here and there he gave certain gaps. Okay, here and there he gave certain gaps. The gap is because he predicted, he thought that there may be more elements present in our nature. Many scientists may discover the new elements. So when the new elements come into a picture, you should have a place in a periodic table, right? So that is the reason everywhere, somewhere, here and there, he left some gaps. Okay, those gaps is because the next discovered elements. Okay, similarly, after boron, he gave some gap. Okay, after silicon, he gave some gap. And after aluminium also he gave some gap. Examples, many gaps, not only these 3 gaps, he gave many gaps also here and there. Particularly I'm telling, after boron he gave some gap, and after silicon there is a gap, after aluminium also we have a gap. And luckily during his time only, there were the 2 elements discovered, that is germanium and gallium. Germanium and gallium. Okay, and in the gap he has written a word. After silicon he has written a word, eca silicon aka silicon. After aluminium, whatever gap is there, no, that gap he called it as eka aluminium. Eka aluminium. And after boron, whatever gap he gave, no, there he has actually written as eka boron. Eka boron. Okay, so because, you know, during his time only these two elements were already discovered, and he actually predicted germanium may be similar to silicon, he thought. Okay, and gallium may be similar to aluminium, he thought. And the elements were just discovered during his time. They were not given a name like germanium and gallium. Okay, these elements were not having a name actually. So he didn't know how to call those elements. That is the reason he called germanium as eka silicon. Okay, and he called gallium as eka aluminium. Remember this, eka in the sense what? Next, after silicon, the next element is what? Germanium. So eka means next, eka means next. Okay, so during his time they were just discovered, but names were not given. That is the reason what he has written is, after silicon he gave some gap, he gave some space, and he called that space as eka silicon. That actually indicates which element? Germanium. Okay, and similarly after aluminium also, the gap he left, he called it as eka aluminium. And what does that eka aluminium is? Nothing but gallium. Okay, he was not knowing the names, no. So he called the gaps with eka silicon and eka aluminium. And luckily, you know, the elements what that was discovered were exactly matched with silicon properties and aluminium properties. You know, germanium was matched with silicon properties, gallium was matched with aluminium properties. Similarly, and after boron, whatever gap he left, no, he called it as eka boron, and eka boron is nothing but scandium. Anyway, but here scandium's properties and boron properties are completely different. But, you know, in silicon case and aluminium case, he was correct. So like that, you know, for the new discovery of elements, to give spaces for them, to give places for them, he left certain gaps in his periodic table. And more details and limitations we will discuss looking at his original periodic table. Okay. This is our Mendeleev's periodic table, okay? He divided his periodic table into 8 groups. You can observe here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 groups. And you know, 6 periods. Periods in the sense horizontal rows, okay? How many are there? 6 are there. Vertical columns, how many are there? That is nothing but groups, that is 8. And every group has again subdivided into A and B. Okay, till group number 7, you can observe that A column and B column. Okay, and 8th group has not divided into any subgroups. 3 elements together he placed in one slot, that is in one position. Okay. And now, the thing is, he studied every element's reactivity with oxygen and hydrogen, isn't it? So, whichever elements react in a similar way with oxygen and hydrogen, he placed it in one particular group. Say, for example, all the elements of group 2, it may be under A column or B column. Okay, A column, what is there? Beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, you know, barium is there. B column, what is there? Zinc is there, cadmium is there, mercury is there. So all these elements, when they react with oxygen, they will give oxides of the formula RO. What is R here? R can be any of these second group elements. Okay, say for example calcium, if it reacts with oxygen, what oxide you will get? CaO you will get. Okay, like that, all these elements react a similar way with oxygen and hydrogen. Okay, and now one more thing is, he has left the gaps in his periodic table. Say actually after aluminium, he in his original periodic table he didn't mention it as Ga. Here he left a gap, and there he mentioned it as eka aluminium. Okay, so that time gallium was discovered, but name was not given. That is the reason he named this element as eka aluminium. Later scientists thought that it is nothing but gallium, which is having similar properties as that of aluminium and boron. So they placed it here. See, it was the future thing that he thought it before only, okay, that there would be some element and it may be matched with aluminium. So here he has written it as Eka. Aluminium. Same way here, below silicon actually germanium is there, no? In his original periodic table, if you see, you will find it as Eka silicon. Okay, he didn't mention it as Ge. He called this gap as Eka silicon. Okay, now that Eka silicon is nothing but germanium. Like that, here and there, you know, you can find many gaps in his periodic table. That is for future discovery. See, here you don't have any element. Here you don't have any element. So, all these gaps he left purposefully is because for the newer elements that can be discovered in the future. Fine. This is all the different things about his periodic table. Now, let us talk about the limitation. Okay, so the first limitation is about the isotopes here. So, what do you mean by isotopes? Elements having same atomic number but different mass. Almost all the elements have isotopes. Say there are three types of hydrogens actually. Hydrogen 1, hydrogen 2, hydrogen 3 we say. Okay. So hydrogen 1 means hydrogen which is having atomic mass 1. Hydrogen 2 in the sense hydrogen which is having atomic mass 2. Hydrogen 3, hydrogen has atomic mass 3. So masses will be different. Atomic number will be same. Okay, so even hydrogens, three types are there, hydrogen 1, hydrogen. Hydrogen 1 only he has placed, but where is the position for hydrogen 2? Where is the position for hydrogen 3? Yes or no? See, when he considered atomic mass, when he arranged all the elements in the increasing order of their atomic mass, hydrogen 2 also should have some position. Hydrogen 3 also should have some position. Hydrogen 1 is here, hydrogen 2 should come here or hydrogen 2 should come here, but where is the position for isotopes? No. And carbon, three types are there. Carbon 12 is there, carbon 13 is there, carbon 14 is there. Carbon 12 only he mentioned. Where is carbon 13? It should come here, no? Instead of nitrogen, carbon 13 should come. When he considered atomic mass, that is what the thing that we all accept. Yes or no? Carbon 12 is there, carbon 13, carbon 14, they should come beside carbon. But where are those isotopes? Where is the position for those isotopes? See, he didn't clearly mention about isotopes. So this is the major drawback of Mendeleev's periodic table. Second limitation is you can observe the positions of tellurium and iodine. This position you observe, guys. Tellurium and iodine. See, how we arranged this periodic table, elements has been arranged in the increasing order of their atomic masses, isn't it? See, here atomic mass is 6.9, here 9.0, 10, 12, 14, 15, 18, again 22, 24, 29, right? See, this is how he has arranged. But, you know, here also you can observe here. 29 is aluminium, 28 is silicon. See, it's decreased. Silicon should come here, aluminium should go there, no? So, here is one pair you will find mismatched. And also here, technetium and iodine, 127, 126. Actually, 126 should come here, 127 should go there, isn't it? So, here and there are some pairs, okay? So, whose positions have been misplaced if you consider their atomic masses, okay? So, this is another drawback of Mendeleev's periodic table. Okay, and the other one is position of hydrogen. Position of hydrogen. Okay, hydrogen's position is also not very much clear here. See, hydrogen has similar properties as that of lithium, sodium, and potassium. Also, hydrogen has similar properties as that of fluorine, chlorine, bromine, also. Okay, but he arranged hydrogen along with lithium, sodium, potassium. Why? What is the reason behind placing hydrogen in the group where lithium, sodium, potassium comes? Why can't he place under group of fluorine, chlorine, bromine? Because hydrogen has both properties, similar to this group also, similar to this group also. But he placed it in first group. For this, the reason he could not explain properly. Okay, so these are the three limitations you have to keep in mind. First limitation is there is no proper positions for isotopes. okay, and the other one is these mismatched elements. See, actually when he considered atomic mass, you know, this silicon has 28, 28 should come here, aluminium should go there, and same way technetium and iodine. So this mismatched pairs you have to concentrate. This is second drawback. And the third limitation or drawback is the position of hydrogen is uncertain. That means not very, very proper. Okay, fine.